And now, WTOE Radio Live, brought to you by ThroughOurEyes.org.
Cheryl Echevarria of Echevarria Travel, your one-on-one travel agent, making your travel dreams come true, home of the independent traveler. Whether you're sighted, blind, or disabled, whether you use a cane, guide dog, or sighted guide, Echevarria Travel will get you there safely. Come and learn more about traveling independently.
Come with me, let's go. Come with me, let's go. Let's go. Come with me, let's go.
Hello and Happy New Year, everybody. Happy 2013, the very first of ECHEVARRIA Travel shows for the month. And welcome back. Today we're going to be starting out the new year with two guests. My first guest after our first break is Mr. Andrew J. Garnett. He is the president and CEO of Special Needs at Sea. And as you know from listening to me or watching our shows, I specialize in cruising, and his company rents scooters and wheelchairs and oxygen and different kind of beds and different kind of chairs for you to enjoy your travel, whether if you're cruising or going to a foreign destination. He's the man you want to talk to tonight. So if you have any questions tonight, the number to call in is 1-888-572-0141. And on the second half hour of the show, we're going to have Christine Faltz Grassman. She's not only a friend, but she's also a client of ours. And her family went to Ireland in 2011. And everybody in her family is blind, and we're going to talk about their experience in Ireland for her daughter's sweet 16. So before we go to break, I want to give you my contact information as usual. It's Cheryl Echevarria. I'm the owner of EchevarriaTravel.com. And you can reach me at 631-456-5394. Or reservations at EchevarriaTravel.com. And we specialize in pole to pole. Any place you want to go, anything you want to do, we'll get you there safely and you'll be able to enjoy it. So we're going to take a 2-minute break. While we come back, I'll bring on Mr. Garnett and we'll talk about special needs equipment for your next vacation. Stay tuned.
Don't go anywhere. There'll be more show right after these messages.
What is a hero? Are heroes born? Or are they made? In after-school programs, your kids will uncover hidden strengths, discover they have the power to change their future, and find the hero inside themselves. Let us know you want after-school programs in your area. Call 1-800-USA-LEARN. After-school programs. Helping kids find the hero within. You put your keys between your knuckles. You walk in well-lit areas. Someone approaches you and you grasp your cell phone tightly, ready at any second to dial the number for help. You lock the door behind you. Once, twice, maybe three times. Now you feel safe. Secure, you think you've made the right choices to protect yourself. Think again. Because if you're not making healthy choices, you could be one of the nearly 2 out of 3 women killed by cancer, diabetes, heart disease, or stroke. So eat right, get active, don't smoke, see your doctor, and live. Learn to protect yourself from yourself at 1-866-399-6789 or visit us at everydaychoices.org. A message from the American Cancer Society, American Diabetes Association, American Heart Association, and the Ad Council.
I can listen.
I can cook.
Good. I can coach.
Kids with something to do are less likely to do drugs.
I can drive.
I can paint.
I can dance.
A little of your time can make a lifetime of difference.
I can read.
I can help.
You can help. Call toll-free 1-877-KIDS-313 to find out about community drug prevention programs.
I can keep a kid off drugs.
Come with me, let's go.
And we are back. Tonight we have, like I said, we have two guests on. My first guest, some of you may already use some of the products that this gentleman rents for on the cruise lines, whether you could be using a scooter or a wheelchair, or if you're a guide dog user, the boxes that are used for the doggies to go to the bathroom on the box on cruise ships. This gentleman is the president and CEO of Special Needs at Sea. His name is Andrew J. Garnett. Andy, are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for coming on the show tonight. We really appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. I appreciate the opportunity.
Well, as Andy and I met a couple of years ago, basically on Facebook while I was searching around for equipment and learning about where different things come from on the cruise lines. And Andy we got in touch with each other, started talking. And, Andy, I want you to give us a little background about yourself. I usually go into this with all my guests. Please let us know who Andrew Garnett is, what is Special Needs at Sea, why did you go into the special needs industry? Give us a little background about yourself.
Okay, sure. Actually, I used to be in staffing industry. I used to staff for AT&T call centers. Mm-hmm. And AT&T decided to get out of that business. So I went through a series of downsizings. And one day, a travel agent asked me if I'd be interested in supplying this kind of equipment because they had requests for it. I figured I had nothing to lose. I couldn't find work. And so I started in my bedroom. And I used to wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and drive up to Port Canaveral to make my deliveries, and then drive across the state to Tampa, make my deliveries there, and then drive back to Fort Lauderdale so I could be ready for the next day. And really, I gained a passion for making it possible for people who want to travel to be able to not only to go, but to have a great time. And we've, to date, made deliveries in 99 different cities and 30 different countries around the world. And happy to say we're making it possible for people to go and have fun.
That's really awesome. I mean, in this day and age, especially with what your company's doing, you're doing something called that special needs certification for people like myself who are travel agents. Can you give us a little heads up on that as well?
Sure. Well, I had so many travel agents that would come to me at trade shows, and I'd see them at every trade show every time, and they would say, I really want to learn about this, I really want to do this, but they all suffered from what I call paralysis by analysis. So they would just were afraid to get started. So I said, we need to do something, and we created this course. It's online. It's not too involved, although you do have to pass a test, but it's 3 different modules. And if you do it all the way through, it takes about 65 minutes to complete the whole course. And once you've completed it, you have an understanding of the special needs market. You'll understand how big it is, how to approach it, different kinds of equipment, the differences between different kinds of wheelchairs and things like that. So to date, we have over 1,000 people who have become certified. It doesn't cost anything for someone to take. And for those who are interested in travel agents who are interested in CLIA credits, it is accredited by CLIA, and they will get 5 CLIA credits for free.
That's awesome, especially as travel agents always looking to get more training out there, especially now the market is, I should say, the travel industry is stepping back and looking at the money that they can make on people that are special needs that are disabled and everything. So we're actually, it's a two-way street where the disabled community is actually coming out, let's say, of the closet, no offense to anybody, to travel more independently. And your company offers, you know, as I was saying, information for service animals, for the boxes on the cruise ships. You do some rail for some of the cruise lines. You do all different kinds of wheelchair and scooters, and a lot of things on there. I was noticing that when I was taking the course and learning about your equipment, that, you know, it's oxygen and all the different kinds of oxygens and the different beds that you offer and all that. I'm sorry, Lenny, were you saying something? Yeah, it's my dog. Max is listening, so that's his rattling around. Plus, I'm a little hoarse, so maybe hear the chains in me. Ha ha. Anyway, just want to let people know the lines are open. If you have questions in reference to any of this equipment or whether or not you may need something like this for your next trip, the number is 1-888-572-0141. And the way somebody would get equipment for your cruise, you would either contact the company themselves or you would contact me at Cheryl Echevarria, and we would rent the equipment for you, and then we would let the cruise line know that you're having this available. It actually, if somebody is actually using a wheelchair or a scooter or a specialty bed or a chair or something like that, it's already on the cruise when you arrive. It's not like you have to, it's going to be dropped off at your home and you have to return it to your home. It's actually on your cruise ship. You leave, you know, and then when you leave to go home off your cruise, you leave it there. So it's very convenient, especially if you have a scooter at home. Sometimes people are flying and they don't want to get their own wheelchairs or scooters damaged. This way you have the opportunity of having it available to you without ruining what you may be afraid to take with you. Andy, what other equipment do you offer besides, you know, wheelchairs and scooters and the oxygen? What other kind of equipment do you offer?
Well, that's a good question. I'm going to elaborate a little bit more on equipment we have for people who have a visual impairment. We print the menus in Braille for the various ships. Norwegian Cruise Line has made a dedicated effort to make sure that every menu on that cruise line, they have many different restaurants, so they have a lot of menus, but they have made a dedicated effort to have all of those menus printed in Braille. And as Cheryl was mentioning regarding the relief area for the dogs, it's always a good joke part of my presentation. People say, I've been on cruises so many times and I've never seen where that area is. What is it? So what the cruise line does is they create a 4x4 wooden box, and then they call our company and have us deliver sod or cypress mulch on board. And people always ask, where is that on the ship? And the obvious answer is on the poop deck, right?
Very good.
That's always part of one of my presentations. But pretty much anything special needs. We do a lot with Make-A-Wish Foundation. They'll ask us for even specialty baby food, gluten-free items that they need delivered. Basically, we're dedicated to delivering an accessible world. So it's not just the wheelchairs. It's not just the oxygen or the hospital beds. We do have those beach wheelchairs. So imagine someone who's never put their foot in the water and they use a regular wheelchair. The wheels are too narrow to get through the sand. Plus, you don't want to get it wet with the salt water. It will corrode the wheelchair. So we have wheelchair that has balloon tires on it. It's made out of aluminum, so it won't corrode when you take it into the water. And it gives that person who lives in Iowa, who's never seen the ocean, the opportunity to not only be there, but actually get into the water and enjoy. So it's, to me, it's a feel-good business. We'll also provide sign language interpreters if requested, alert kits. Someone who has a hearing impairment can't necessarily hear someone knocking at the door, or if there's an emergency on board, they don't know that there is a fire, they can't hear the fire alarm or the general alarm. So we provide equipment on board that will alert them as to the fact that someone's knocking at the door, if the phone is ringing, so they can connect to the TTY, or if there's a general alarm, so they're aware. It's a feel-good business.
Definitely, definitely. And that's basically one of the reasons I went into the business myself. Back in 2009, I couldn't find a travel agent that wanted to work for me. And so I decided to go into the business myself. So, yeah, it is a feel-good business when you get somebody who's never traveled that is disabled or even not disabled, and they go someplace for the first time. It's definitely a feel-good business. I wanted to step back a little bit, and you mentioned Norwegian Cruise Line. I've been working a long time with Norwegian to get them very up to date and accessible, so it's been a win-win situation for everybody, and I'm glad that's going on. I was going to even ask you about the people that are hearing impaired or deaf. I had a friend who wanted me to ask you questions about that, but you already answered them about sign language. You provide the alarm clocks or the vibrators in the bed to wake them up, or what other services do you offer to the deaf?
That has a tactile alert, which is the vibrating bed shaker alert, visual alert, so it has the strobe light, and there's also an audible alert, so someone who has a hearing impairment doesn't necessarily have a complete hearing loss.
Correct.
But one thing I'd like to elaborate on for your listeners that maybe have never been on a cruise, in my opinion, cruising is the best form of transportation for someone who has a special need, because your hotel is accessible and your hotel moves for you. So if you want to see different cities, and maybe you want to get a taste of different cities and decide which one you like best and you want to go back to, by booking with Cheryl on a cruise, you can go and see these different places knowing that your hotel, the cruise ship, is accessible, and the various destinations you go to that Cheryl will arrange tours for you, knowing that they will be accessible for you, so you'll have a great time. It's just really a good opportunity to get out and enjoy the world. You don't have to enjoy the world only by watching television or looking on the internet. Because of people like Cheryl, you're able to go out and experience it for yourself, and you should.
Thanks for saying that. We brought that up. I just wanted to give a little announcement that the NFB of Florida is having their state convention February 7th through the 10th, 2014. And you don't have to be a member of the NFB of Florida to go. I have held separate space just for friends and family, but we're trying to get you NFB of Florida members out there going, so if you're listening, it's the perfect time to call in before the end of the half hour, before we have to say goodbye to Andrew. But the line is open. It's 1-888-572-0141. I know there's too many eights there. I get so confused. Wow. So if you're out there, you have a question, please call in. We'd love to speak to you tonight. And also, please remember the people that are going on the NFB New Jersey cruise in April. This is also a great time to ask. Now, another thing I found out while I was doing the studying on the for the special needs certification, there's actually a life jacket for a guide dog. I thought that was really interesting. Did your company create that, or is that something that a lot of people are asking for now?
Well, we didn't create it. definitely didn't create it. However, the cruise lines keep a certain quantity on board at all times, but when there's a large group with service animals, what they will do is they will ask us to provide additional life vests for the dogs. So it makes sense. It's a member of the family, and you want to make sure that they're safe too.
Definitely, definitely. Anyway, excuse me. Lenny, do we have any calls out there? No calls. Oh, goodness gracious. Anyway, Andy, as you know, the NFV National Convention is coming up in July, and we do hope you could come down and speak to us at the Travel and Tourism Division meeting. We're having it July 2nd. You don't have to give us an answer now. I don't want to put you on the spot, but we'd love to have you come down and talk to us while we're there. If you can, that'll be great. And I hope to have you back on in the show again in a couple of months if you're able to do so.
Sure. Yeah, we'll talk.
I'm just trying to see what else there is out there. Sorry, my nose is dripping, and people that are listening, I apologize for that. Are you going to be at any of the travel agent trade shows coming up? I'm going to be at the New York Times trade show in New York City, so if anybody is in New York City, it's open to the public the 19th and the 20th at the Jacob Javits Center. If anybody that's interested in wanting to know the latest and greatest in traveling, January 18th is for travel agents only, so a lot of suppliers will be there. Will you be having a booth this year at the trade show?
No, we try to support the travel agents when it comes to these consumer type shows, like the New York Times show.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes travel agents kind of feel that we're competing with them if we go to a consumer show, and we're really here to support the travel agents. We were the first company to ever offer a commission to a travel agent for special needs type of equipment. But to elaborate a little bit more, our company is also called Special Needs Group, not just special needs at sea. One of the reasons that we started a transition was because people would rent from us for the cruise, and then they would say, well, I'm going to be in Miami for 2 days before the cruise. Can you recommend someone? And then we would tell them, sure, we can do it for you. And then they would say, no, you can't. You're only at sea. So we can provide at any of these destinations that are major cruise port cities, such as Miami, Fort Lauderdale. If you are traveling to go to the New York Times travel show and require special needs equipment, we can deliver it there. And, we had to grow the fleet and buy all of this equipment, because if a ship is sailing from New York to Barcelona, Spain, we have to pick up the equipment in Barcelona. And then when the ship sails from Barcelona to Dubai, we need to have an agent in Dubai who picks up the equipment. And then when that ship goes to Sydney. So that's how we expanded our network. And we own 99.9% of all of the equipment that we put on the vessels. It's owned by us. So you can imagine we have a lot of inventory all around the world. And we do that because we want to make sure that we have consistency on the type of equipment, make sure that it's good. And if a ship sails one way, if we're renting it from someone else, they won't be too happy when it leaves their town.
Right. Other than doing the cruise lines, would you rent to somebody that's actually like going to Rome or to London or something like that? Or it has to be somebody that's cruising?
No, we'll do it land-based only as well. We do provide service in Orlando, which definitely is not a cruise city. And many times people just come or go to a city to enjoy the land portion, and of course we'll provide the equipment there. We do that all the time.
Okay. Just trying to see, Lenny. Yes. Okay. Because I keep hearing something bouncing around. I'm going in and out. So anyway, I want to thank Andrew for coming on tonight. And I want to reiterate that what his company does and what I can do. If you're contacting me and you're going on a cruise, you're going on some kind of land destination, and his company can service it, you go through me, I will contact their company and we'll get you all the equipment that is needed, whether it's a wheelchair, scooter, especially the oxygen out there. You can't always bring the oxygen you're using at home. You need special oxygen tanks that can go on the cruise line. Some of the older models cannot go on the cruise line, and you have to get the right tanks for the cruise lines. Also, they have the different kinds of walkers, the ones that you could push, the ones that you could push for a little bit and then sit down in. If you run, you know, if you're not a fast walker, you need to stop and relax. Am I missing anything? I think we've gone through most of the products that you service. And you know, unless I'm forgetting any particular thing that does, it's not sticking out in my head tonight.
No, you've covered most of it. The wheelchairs, mobility scooters, power chairs, hospital beds, patient lifts, oxygen, cylinders, liquid oxygen, bed wedges.
I have to say, those bed wedges came in handy. We actually cruised in October with a couple that was celebrating their anniversary. We were celebrating together. We ordered the scooter and the bed wedges because she's used to the adjustable beds, and it was perfect for her because she couldn't lie flat. And you also do the hospital beds?
Yeah, hospital beds. We'll also do the Lazy Boy recliners and lift chairs. Shower okay. safety, like transfer benches, commode chairs, shower stools. So just okay. all the different kinds of equipment.
Well, Andy, I want to thank you for coming on tonight and explaining special needs group. And we hope to speak to you again. And I look forward to meeting you in Florida sometime in July. And have a happy new year. And thank you for coming on tonight.
Thank you. Happy new year.
Happy new year. And when we come back from our break, I'm going to have Christine Grassman from Long Island on the show talking about her trip to Ireland in 2011. So stay tuned. We'll be back in a moment.
Hi, I'm Keith Zale, your announcer here at WTOE Radio Network. We're going to take a little bit long with this break to save our files for podcasts. So don't go anywhere because there'll be more of the Echevarria Travel Show in just a bit.
Nothing inspires imagination like reading, and it's never too early to start reading to your children. When you open a book, you can explore new worlds like the ones in the Chronicles of Narnia.
Everything you see is Narnia.
Impossible.
You can make new friends, discover amazing adventures, and most of all, have fun.
Are you prepared for what awaits you?
To find out more about the wonders of reading, you can visit the Library of Congress website at www.loc.gov. There, you can learn more about books, play fun games, discover cool facts, and so much more. You can log on to www.loc.gov and let your journey begin. This message has been brought to you by the Library of Congress and the Ad Council.
It slices, it dices, with razor-like edges that never need sharpening. It's not a blender, it's not a set of steak knives, it's car windshield. And now, it can be yours. Here's how. Next time you're in a car and the driver's driving recklessly, simply say nothing. That's right. Let them change CDs. Let them text on their phones. Ignore that little voice in your head that's trying to warn you. And you too can experience car windshield. Passengers who have tried car windshield agree. It's a smash. Car windshield may not be for everyone, as it can lead to severe side effects and even death. Please consult your physician after you've experienced car windshield. Passengers who wish to avoid car windshield can do so by following simple steps, like trusting their instincts, speaking up, and telling their friends to slow down.
In the real world, there is no spokesperson to prevent reckless driving. There's only you. Speak up.
Act now. Paramedics are standing by.
This has been a message from the Ad Council. For more information, go to youarethespokesperson.com.
Hi, this is Kathy Gabry. I'm the editor of The Sounding Board, the magazine of the National Federation of the Blind of New Jersey. I'd like you to know that highlights of The Sounding Board are now available as a digital broadcast. Check us out online at www.nfbnj.org or as a podcast at www.throughoureyes.org. We look forward to your thoughts, ideas, and articles. Please send them to me at specialk38@aol.com.
Thank you, and we're back. You know, when it comes to fighting crime, he's never going to roll over. He's McGruff the Crime Dog.
Roll over. You're okay, Joy.
Thanks.
And I got two words to make your neighborhood safer.
Uh-huh.
Coffee cake.
Ah, the old poison coffee cake trick. The crook takes a bite, falls down to the ground.
No, it's for your neighbors.
You want to poison your neighbors?
No, never.
Oh, thank goodness.
No, for 25 years, I've been giving tips about preventing crime. One of them is to invite people over for a cup of coffee and share the problems you see on your street and what to do about them.
That's great.
You can invite your local police officer to help, too.
You know, I hear they're very fond of donuts.
Oh, that's just a myth.
Oh, well, I come to your doghouse for coffee cake in a safer neighborhood.
Now you're talking. You can cut down on crime by not just locking your door, but opening up to your neighbors.
Still, a 10-pound bundt cake dropped on a bad guy's foot could help.
It couldn't hurt. And go on to weprevent.org for other tips could help, too.
A message from the U.S. Department of Justice, Crime Prevention Coalition of America, National Crime Prevention Council, and the Ad Council.
Come with me, let's go.
Hello, and we're back. Happy New Year again. If you just tuned in, we just recently had Andrew Garnett from Special Needs Group. He will be back on another show. And coming up right now, I have a client and also a good friend, Christine Faltz Grassman from Merrick, Long Island, New York. And I actually sent her and her family in 2011 to Ireland for her daughter's sweet 16. Unfortunately, we don't have a video connection, but Christine is on Skype. So, Christine, are you there?
I am here.
Christine, thank you for coming on tonight.
I'm glad to be here. Anything to help my travel maven.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I mean, Christine, I try to send her as many places as she allows me to do so. And like I said, we're very good friends. She was one of the very first clients I had that actually I sent overseas, which I was very nervous about. I'm always nervous when I send my clients anywhere. And Christine, why don't you give us a little background about why you wanted to go to Ireland and your time that you were there? So we could start with that.
Well, there were basically two reasons why we decided on Ireland. First of all, it was someplace that I always wanted to go because I have ancestors who came from Ireland during the potato famine, and I wanted to do a little bit of research, see if I could find some information about them. And the other reason was because my daughter was very interested in traveling for her Sweet 16 present as opposed to a party. And so we put down a couple of countries and we discussed it and we decided that we would choose Ireland. And we decided to focus on one country. Initially, we had been considering maybe going to two or three, but we decided that we would rather just spend our time in one country than floating around from country to country.
Now, since you're totally blind, your husband Gary's legally blind, and Samantha has some vision left, or she's totally blind as well?
For functional reasons, she's for functional functionality, she's totally blind. She has some light perception, as do I on bright days, but it's really not functional.
For somebody that is interested in going to Ireland that's blind, that has, like all of us, whether some kind of vision loss, how did you feel about going to Ireland? How were you treated? What kind of mobility you think that people need when they go to a place like Ireland or any place at all?
I really think that anybody who's blind, whether it's totally blind or legally blind with some usable vision, needs to be an excellent independent traveler to go anywhere, really. Unless you're exceedingly familiar with a particular area, I think that you really need, just for purposes of your own safety, to have very good travel skills, because anything can happen in any scenario in any place. So I would say that regardless of where you go, you should be an excellent traveler. As far as Ireland, having been there, I can safely tell you that I would, without reservation, travel there on my own, with no concerns whatsoever.
Okay. Now, trying to get my thoughts here. When you went there, explain the towns you went to. What did you experience? I mean, people think, well, you're blind, what are you going to look at? And I know from you telling me all the experiences you had, what did you enjoy most? What were some of your favorite places and towns you went to? And, you know, I tell people when they're traveling someplace, you're not, you know, but you got all other senses besides your vision. So, you know, what would you tell somebody that's interested in going to Ireland, or what you did, what exactly you did? And I know CIE tours that I use, they're wonderful, as long as I let people know ahead of time that whatever disability the person has, that they're very professional about it.
They were very professional. All of our tour guides were excellent. Nobody tried to stop us from doing anything we wanted to do. For example, one of the things that we did was to go to Blarney Castle. And Blarney Castle has, I can't remember the number now, I don't know why, but there's quite a few steps. And they are not what you would call regular steps. They're very uneven. Some of them are narrower than others. They're not what you would call even footing. Nobody tried to stop us. Nobody questioned us as to whether, you know, this was something safe that we were embarking upon. We got up to the top. We came back down. There was absolutely no issue. Additionally, we went to one of the isles. We went to the island of Inishmore, and there again was a fort that we climbed towards the top of. And again, very precarious footing. You want to be not necessarily in good shape, but you want to have good balance to do these particular two activities. And especially because it's very windy at the top, and it can start raining at a moment's notice, so things can get slippery. We actually had really good weather. And I found those two things fun, but the most fun I think I had was in Galway, around the ocean. I love to be by the ocean. I love to be by the water and by the cliffs of Dover. You could really hear the ocean. There was a flautist, and there was actually a penny whistle player, and there was also a harpist. So the combination of the music plus the wind blowing and the waves and the people enjoying themselves around us, it was a really fantastic experience. And the time we went was August, and we had very beautiful weather, absolutely gorgeous. It barely rained when we were there. We were told over and over how we really lucked out. And I would say that even though Ireland is known for its scenery, there are many things that you can do that you can have a full experience of being outside, of the ocean, of doing things hands-on in a museum. The tour guides are fantastic. They're interesting. They're funny. We went to a show that had a lot of music, a comedian. So there were tons of things that we did that we really enjoyed. And I don't feel that, yes, I was a little envious of the oohing and aahing as people were rushing out of the bus to take pictures and get this fantastic scenery, which we put together. My mother-in-law put together a scrapbook of our trip, and people are just amazed at the scenery over in Ireland. So, yeah, it would be nice to see it, but you can enjoy Ireland fully and completely without being able to see a thing.
And I try to stress that to anybody that's coming to me and saying, look, I can't see, what can I do? And I always tell people, look, we got sense of smell, taste, touch, all our senses available to us. So, you know, sometimes in some scenery you don't want to see and some you do, and you just make the best of what you can enjoy. When you went on the buses, you were mentioning the tour guide, so they were very descriptive of what you were looking at, even though you couldn't see what they were looking at.
We had a few different tour guides. One of them was very hands-off. He would tell us a few really amusing anecdotes. We had a lot of fun with him. And a good portion of the trip, we would do our own thing, listen to our music, talk amongst each other, read. And then we had another tour guide who was constantly singing songs with us and telling jokes and telling stories and giving us history. So there was a real variety in the manners in which the tour guides approached the various tours. And absolutely, we got a lot of information from all of them, but they definitely had their own distinctive personality. Some of them were more hands-off, come up to the front, ask me questions if you want, and others were constantly giving us information.
Wonderful. Like you said, when you went in August, you had no problem with the weather, but coming back to the States,
That's when we had a problem with the weather.
Yes, because in 2011, we had Hurricane Irene. And it was very interesting. It's one of the reasons I insist on my clients getting travel insurance.
Definitely a good move.
Definitely. You might as well finish because I'd rather have them hear from you than from me talking as a travel agent of what you went through coming back.
Okay, well, we knew that there was a hurricane coming, and I kept going onto Facebook to sort of check statuses, check with friends to see what was going on. And it wasn't exactly clear. We really believed that we were going to be able to fly in before they closed the airports. We knew it was going to happen eventually, but we figured we'd get in. Unfortunately, when I woke up early in the morning in the hotel and went to Facebook to check, I learned that the airports were closing off flights, all flights after a certain time. I think it was about noon. And our flight, I believe, if I recall correctly, was supposed to come in at 1:15. So we were shot out. So we went to the airport and we figured, okay, we'll get the next flight out to New York. All the flights to New York, at least through Aer Lingus, were closed until the following Saturday. We did not know and we didn't think to try to find out if we could get a flight out on a different airline. We would have preferred to stay in Dublin another 2 or 3 days if we had to stay anywhere for 2 or 3 days, but we didn't think of checking other airlines. So we decided to look at Aer Lingus and decide where we could go in the States as close to New York as possible, and we decided on Chicago. So we took the flight to Chicago. Meanwhile, I left you a message, Cheryl, saying what was going on and to please get us a hotel that we could quickly get to when we arrived in Chicago. And sure enough, when we landed in Chicago, in less than half an hour, we were through customs. I had the information from you that you'd left on my cell phone with the hotel name and the reservation and everything, and we called, got a shuttle, went over to the hotel, and we were safely ensconced, you know, literally within half an hour of landing. And, you know, we spent the next 3 days in Chicago, and for a good portion of that time, a whole bunch of us, including you, Cheryl, and myself, and my parents, and a whole bunch of people were trying to get us flights into New York, which wouldn't bankrupt us, and the travel insurance company. And we just couldn't get anything until we found something flying out from Chicago to Baltimore. We had to go across town to another airport, so we had to take a cab to do that. Then we flew to Baltimore, and we thought we would take Amtrak to New York. So we went to buy the tickets to Amtrak to New York, and we learned that after Philadelphia, we couldn't go any further because of the flooding in New Jersey, I believe in Trenton, and they had closed down the stops between Philly and New York on Amtrak. So we decided when we got into Philly, maybe we take Greyhound or some other, you know, conveyance to get to New York. And I called to let my parents know what was going on, and my father decided to come and pick us up in Philly. So that's basically it. It was far more of an ordeal and far more exhausting getting from Chicago to New York than it was getting either from New York to Dublin and Dublin to Chicago. It was really exhausting. But because we had the travel insurance, we got all of our money back for the hotels, for the meals, for the flights, for Amtrak. And it was smooth. You know, it was as smooth as it could be under the circumstances.
Yeah, exactly. And I just want to mention to people that are listening or going to be listening to the recorded show that if you need to go outside of your travel itinerary, get a hotel, an Amtrak, or another flight, hold on to those receipts, because the travel insurance company to pay the claim is going to need proof. And in Christine's situation, she had all the receipts. I sent her via email everything that I got for her, so the hotel, and then she got a couple of flights, and then the Amtrak to get back home. But keep those receipts, because the travel insurance company will reimburse you anything that is considered an emergency, which this was. It was a hurricane. It's not like something that she expected to happen. And she was able to get back home safely. You know, so what I'm telling people, when to travel, when not to travel, you have to remember, even if you're flying to Europe or Asia or Africa or wherever you're going, coming back to the States during a certain time of year, you might get stuck. July, August, September, October. It's also hurricane season here for us. I mean, we joke about it now that New York is the next, you know, the new hurricane state next to Florida. Unfortunately, we had a Hurricane Irene and Hurricane Sandy, but you never know. We are in that region that gets hurricanes, so it may not affect you where you're going, but it may affect you when you're coming back. Just like right now, we're in winter. You may have plans to go, you know, to Puerto Rico when you're flying out of JFK or Islip or something like that, and, you know, you snowed in. Make sure you get the travel insurance to protect your investment, just like you have travel insurance to protect your health and your house and everything else. It's a little bit of money to save a big investment. Christine, you and I were talking over the holidays about possibly either going to Italy or Ireland in 2014. So if anybody out there is listening, we're looking to do a group in August to Ireland in 2014. So if you're interested in going, give me a call at 631-456-5394 or reservations at echevarriatravel.com. I'm sure Christine will let her friends and family know. I'll let my friends and family know. And we'll have a great time going there. I also want to mention again that we are doing our first trip to Las Vegas and the Grand Canyon for the Travel and Tourism Division. It's October 9th through the 13th of 2013. And the $20% deposit is due by January 30th of 2013, and after that, we have payment plans available to everybody that does want to go. So, Christine, I want to wish you a happy new year. And thank you for
Same
coming
to you.
On tonight. And we will talk to you again in the future if you're willing to come back on.
No problem. Would love to.
Have a great night. Have a happy new year. And wish Gary and Sam and Braden a happy new year as well.
Okay. And good night to Max and Nelson as well.
Good night.
Bye.
I just want to let people know some updated information. If you don't already know, the National Federation of the Blind's National Convention, July 1st through July 6th, 2013, at the Rose and Shingles Center in Orlando, Florida. Reservations are now available. You can call up the hotel. The information is in the Braille monitor, and it's a $90 deposit. So get your rooms ready. As I was mentioning earlier to Andrew Garnett, the travel and tourism meeting will be happening on July 2nd, 2013. And as of right now, I'm having Excess Manager Mark Jones going to be speaking at the meeting. I hope to get Andrew Garnett in with us as well. And I'm also talking to Norwegian Cruise Line to see if they're able to come and talk to us during the travel and tourism meeting. So that's coming up. At the top of the hour at 9 o'clock, we have a new show that debuted last month. It's called Stepping Forward. And I hope you'll listen to the show after that. Plus, remember, WTOE Radio is run by the Northeast Chapter of the NFB in New Jersey, and we rely on donations by you to keep our radio station going. So if you'd like to make a contribution, you could contact me at my information, 631-456-5394, reservations at echevarriatravel.com. If you'd like to be on my show and you travel, give me a call as well. Or if you're a supplier listening, we'd love to have you on. In the coming months, I plan to have Linda Thomas from Looking Good Without Looking On. We've been discussing being on each other's shows. And also Jerry Marino and Janie on. So we look to have all of our WTOE network radio shows, personalities on each other's shows coming up in the future. What else? Oh, yes. February, we're going to have a tape show because February 4th through the 6th, I will be in Washington, D.C. with the rest of the NFB family, advocating on behalf of you, the blind, and for us, the blind. So remember, I walk the walk, and I talk the talk, and I'm here to help us, the blind, out there, whether it's traveling or being more independent in school, work, or at your jobs. Let's see what else. Just going back a little bit more, we still have room on the NFB in New Jersey cruise. April 13th through the 18th, we still have a couple of rooms left if you'd like to go. Last day for us to book you is January 28th, 2013. And as I've been mentioning, the NFB of Florida's state convention is going to be February 7th through the 10th of 2014 on the Norwegian Sky out of Miami, Florida. Hope you can come with us on that cruise. The state affiliate has blocked enough staterooms for their affiliate members to come. I have blocked for friends and family of the NFB of Florida. They're doing this because the next 6-7 years, we're going to have our national convention in Orlando, and they're just looking for different opportunities to go different places and to learn different forms of travel. The friends and family portion of it that I'm doing is also a fundraiser for the NFB of Florida. So you don't have to be a member of the NFB. All the groups that I do, people ask me, well, is your group just for the blind, or I want to go on a group that's dedicated for blind people? all the groups that I advertise and offer is accessible to everybody, not just the blind, not just people in wheelchairs, not people that don't have any disabilities whatsoever. I want people to learn from each other. So if you're saying to me, well, I want to make sure that I can go. If I can't go, then I don't offer it. I have to make sure that I can go as well, since I'm blind myself. I use a guide dog. I use my cane. I use my husband. So as Christine was saying, it's all about knowing your own mobility. And if you need to practice on your mobility, that's part of local travel as well. Get outside your house, walk down the street. Don't walk on the sidewalk. Walk around gravel. I don't mean, you know, totally get off your sidewalk. Test yourself. See if you can, you know, figure out where to go. So anyway, I want to wish everybody Happy New Year. The February show is going to be a pre-recorded show. So God bless and Happy New Year. Take care. And we'll talk to you soon. Happy travels from Echevarria Travel.
The Echevarria Travel Show is brought to you by Echevarria Travel, home of the independent traveler since 2009, specializing in worldwide destinations for the blind community. For more information on Echevarria Travel, call Cheryl at 631-456-5394 or email her at reservations@echevarriatravel.com. All words, ideas, and contents expressed on this show are those of Cheryl Echevarria and not necessarily those of the National Federation of the Blind, the Northeast New Jersey Chapter, or the WTOE Internet Radio Network. Until next time, I'm Keith Zally.
Hi, this is Joe Ruffalo of WTOE Radio. If you are a resident in New Jersey and would like to join one of our chapters or have some more information about our chapters, please contact me at 973-743-0075 or email me at nfbnj@yahoo.com.
Advertise your events on internet radio and podcasts free. Need to advertise your club or organization's next event? Whether it's one announcement or different ones, weekly or monthly, now you can. ThroughOurEyes.org, using our WTOE Radio Live broadcast and our podcasts, give you the ears of the world. You can take advantage of our free offer in one of two ways: recording your announcement on your computer or calling our toll-free telephone number. Visit our website to learn more. Are you stuck in front of your computer listening to our shows? Well, you may be happy to know that you don't have to be anymore. Hi, this is Keith Zally, your announcer here at WTOE Radio. Of course you know we broadcast live on ThroughOurEyes.org, but did you know we simulcast on Facebook, Ustream.tv, as well as all of our show's host websites? And now you don't have to be stuck trying to catch your favorite show on your computer. You can listen or even watch our shows live right on your smartphone or iPad. During broadcast nights, just point your phone or iPad browser to our mobile site, m.throughoureyes.org, and click on the Listen or Watch Live link. WTOE also offers many smart apps for your iPhone, BlackBerry, Android, Windows Mobile, or Nokia phones, iPads too. All for free. Visit our main site, www.throughoureyes.org/appstores.html and download your free app today. Hi, I'm Keith Zally, your announcer here at throughoureyes.org. Thanks for tuning in to WTOE Radio's live broadcast. Our recording session will start shortly. While you are waiting, I'd like to ask all our listeners who have not yet registered at Through Our Eyes to consider doing so. Registering helps us ascertain whom our listeners are, where they come from, if they are blind or visually impaired, as well as other important information which helps us guide us in providing programming that will meet our visitors' needs. I urge all our listeners to register today. It's free and only takes a minute to complete the process. Please read our privacy policy so you can be assured that the information you provide stays with us and only us, and you'll never get any unwanted emails. Well, we're almost ready to begin. Since what you are about to listen to is live, after each recording of the show, you'll hear approximately 15 minutes of music. This is the time we are contacting our next guest for the next show. When the show starts, you'll hear it in its entirety. Our recording sessions usually comprise three separate shows, each about 15 to 20 minutes in length, with approximately 15 minutes between each session. So once again, thanks for listening to WTOE Radio Live. Our recording session will start momentarily. I'm Keith Zally.
Welcome to Stepping Forward, an engaging, no-nonsense approach to life's problems with your host, licensed clinical psychologist, Tamara White. Let Tamara's keen wit and straightforward delivery help make sense out of life's complex issues such as child rearing, sex education in adulthood, dealing with the elderly, and so much more. Tamara will inspire, motivate, and amuse you while dealing with real-world scenarios. And now, here's Tamara.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to the new year. Happy New Year. Welcome to the show, Stepping Forward. I am excited to be with you for our second time, starting into the new year. And we're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to have a lot of fun tonight. So what I've been thinking about is what it is that I wanted to talk with you all about this particular month. And I'm thinking, let's go back to the basics of fresh starts, new beginnings. This is a time of resolutions, and everyone wants to start on the best path that they can for themselves. Me too. We all do. So here's what I'm thinking. I was looking back on some of like articles that I have sent in and speaking engagements that I participated in. And in my job, what I have found is at this new year, my biggest clientele base are generally children. And I try to help them and try to figure out everything that's going on with them. But at the same time, I learn so much. So what I really want to do is let's take a look. And there's so many popular authors who have mentioned children in their works and philosophies. And there's one that you probably have already heard about, and it's Everything I Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. So I want to go a little bit before kindergarten. And my person of choice happens to be the four-year-old daughter that I have. I have a 21-year-old. I have a 20-year-old, 17, and 6. So when I started this a couple of years ago, and I was flipping through a lot of my play therapy information, and I ran across the article from Robert Fulman based on everything I didn't know I learned in kindergarten. So I thought, well, you know, I have a preschooler, so let me just kind of see if I can really try to educate myself a little bit. There are so much more education in our lives right behind, besides books and going to school and trying to learn everything that we can. If we could just observe, then sometimes we can learn. So I did that, and I took sweet little Emma, that's my little one, and I call her crazy little Emma because, as you're going to see as we go along, she is in fact crazy. She's crazy. She screams with delight for no reason in inopportune moments. She dances as if no one's watching. She says whatever's on her mind. And quite honestly, I think we could all learn from her. So going into the new year, going in and appreciating everything that we have, let's go back to the basics and let's start from scratch. So that this is where this comes from, all right? So I'm going to give you a few crazy things that I have learned from Emma over the course of a couple of years of watching and listening and seeing if I can do kids' translation. So by saying that, what I mean is what she says, I try to translate into our adult kind of ego-centered, maybe mildly narcissistic and pessimistic mind. So maybe we can go back a little bit. All right. First one that came to me during all of this, and again, these articles I have on my website and a couple of children's books as well. So if you've seen this before, if you want to look again, then you're going to find it on my information. All right. Okay, so we're going to talk about these 9 crazy things. So I want you to maybe get something to write with. Let's think about this, because we take notes to give to children. Maybe we should now take notes for children to give to us. Let's take a quick break, and then let's go directly into this, and I'm anxious to see what you think about this, see what we can learn from the little ones, okay? So we're going to take a two-minute break, and we'll be right back.
Stay right where you are. Tamara will be right back.
When you go to court, you want a lawyer to speak for you. But in an emergency, when you can't speak for yourself, you want Medic Alert. Its emblem alerts your rescuers to call the Medic Alert Network, where they'll find out 24/7 about any medical conditions or serious allergies you have. Medic Alert will also contact your family. When it comes to your health, you want peace of mind. Get the emblem that speaks for you. For more information, call 1-800-ID-ALERT or visit medicalert.org.
In the great scheme of things, a minute isn't all that much. Unless you happen to have a stroke. All of a sudden, those minutes count. Minutes that could mean losing your ability to talk. Minutes that could mean losing your ability to walk. Talking, moving, walking, gone. Which is why, if you can get help in time, your stroke can be treated. The warning signs of a stroke include sudden numbness or weakness of the face, sudden trouble seeing, speaking, or understanding. If you experience this, call 911 immediately, because time lost is brain lost. Visit strokeassociation.org or call 1-888-4-STROKE today. A public service announcement brought to you by the American Stroke Association and the Ad Council.
Know the facts about African Americans and stroke. To join the movement to stop stroke, visit strokeassociation.org today.
Hi, I'm Keith Zally, your announcer here at ThroughOurEyes.org. I'd like to ask all our listeners who have not yet registered at Through Our Eyes to consider doing so. Registering helps us ascertain whom our listeners are, where they come from, if they are blind or visually impaired, as well as other important information which helps us guide us in providing programming that will meet our visitors' needs. I urge all our listeners to register today. It's free and only takes a minute to complete the process. Please read our privacy policy so you can be assured that the information you provide stays with us and only us, and you'll never get any unwanted emails.
And now, back to Stepping Forward. Here's Tamara.
Okay, everyone, welcome back. So let's get started into this. So what I was telling you is that I am going to discuss tonight, we're going to talk about things that we can learn from kids, right? My child in particular, okay, I'm a child psychologist by nature. But so I know the disciplines, I know the strategies, I know everything that a postdoctorate gears me to learn. But if we can just sit back and observe, then we're going to learn a lot more. All right. So here's what I want to tell you. So the first one, here's the first thing that I want to talk about. Do we have a slide up for that? Okay. All right, so taking my daughter to the zoo, and I'm thinking, you know, let's look through all these animals, let's look through all the species. So we go into the snake area, the reptiles, right? And they're so colorful, and I'm in Texas, and all I see or hear about are rattlesnakes or just ugly in my mind snakes. So I'm seeing this really multicolored looking thing, and I'm like, you know, that one looks like a snake, doesn't it? And if she can't make me feel any more childish than I already did at this time, she's like, it looks like a snake because it is. Duh. All right. So after I get through this humility part of this, and then I understand, and I'm trying to translate again for her. And here's what I'm getting from that. Sometimes it just simply is what it is. So as an adult, we can say, it just is what it is. So many times things will happen to us on a day-to-day basis, and we'll say, wait, what did you mean by that? What did she mean by that? Why did he look at me that way? What do you think she was trying to do whenever she did this? And, you know, I hear this so much that it's incredible. And I think, you know what? Sometimes it just is what it is. And for some reason, we have been conditioned that we can't take it like that. It is necessary for us to try to give it some analytical, deep meaning. And I think that we're often too ambitious. I think if you can just step back and go, you know, it just is what it is. That's it. She just looked at me because that's how she looks. And she just smiled because that's how she smiles. And so on. Then I think that you will come to some sort of a peace, or I do anyway, because I am terrible about trying to figure out what people are thinking and meaning. And when someone gave me permission to say, it doesn't mean anything, like, I just told you that because that's what all I was thinking, then I felt a little bit of peace with that. Now, if you're at the zoo and it's yellow and green and polka dot and you didn't know it, but it looks like a snake, it probably is. Okay? So, all right. The next one. Who put milk in the refrigerator? Now, remember, I'm not trying to give you this whole huge deep insight. This came from a then four-year-old. Who put milk in the refrigerator? So I can understand that this is an odd question for a toddler, but at the time, this little one likes her milk lukewarm. She does not want it in the refrigerator. And I'm thinking, well, that's where it's supposed to be. So I put it in there and she's like, who put the milk in the refrigerator? And I said, I did. And she said, why? And I said, because it's supposed to be. She asked me who says, and I said, everybody says. And she says, I don't care what everybody says. Now that one got me a little bit, all right? Because the title of a popular book addresses this perfectly. It says, what you think of me is none of my business. However, it is so very difficult for any of us, me, all of us, to take this meaning to heart and understand that we do what we need to do for ourselves, but we are always, always curious and concerned what other people think, right? So, you know, let's go back to Emma's term. Who puts the milk in the refrigerator? Who does this at your house? Who is responsible for literally getting the milk at your house, putting it in the refrigerator? Who takes care of you? Who takes care of your family? When it all comes down to it, all of these people with these great opinions of what it should be like and this great advice that they want to give us, at the end of the day, you need to answer to yourself, right? We don't need to adhere to all of these labels that you've placed on yourself or others have placed on us, right? How people treat you, that's on them, that's their karma. How you react to that is, in response, your karma, all right? So when you're at peace with yourself and you love yourself, it's virtually impossible to do things to yourself that are destructive. Do you see what I... See how I'm getting all this from a little four-year-old? So maybe it's not Emma that's so crazy. Maybe I have a little bit of that myself. So maybe I have a little bit more. All right. So we've gone through a couple of things here. Here's the next one. So she's like, Mom, you can't fix this crazy thing. And she has this cat, this toy cat, this Furby cat, I guess. But it's a couple of years now. So it was kind of one of the newer models, and I think maybe, hopefully, they have gotten to the point to where they knocked out all of the kinks in them. But when she caught this little cat, I bought it for her as a special Christmas gift because it was so it was so important to everyone at this time. This was such a big buy for everyone that I bought it really early on. I put it in the trunk of my car. And as I'm driving places, I hear a cat meow. And it goes based on lighting and sensory movement whatsoever. So I could just be coming home from work and I hear a cat meowing and I'm trying to remember, okay, this is a toy. So anyway, eventually Emma gets this as a Christmas gift and we cannot get it to stop unless you just literally take the batteries out. And I said, I'm going to keep fixing it. And she keeps telling me, you cannot fix this crazy thing. So I listened to that. And again, my translation is, you know what? Sometimes counselor, psychologist, psychiatrist, doctor, whatever you are, family, friend, mentor, perfect person, you can't fix crazy. And by that, that's what I mean. Okay. Go back to number one. It is what it is. Sometimes you cannot fix things or people who do not want to be fixed. There are no pills. There is no counseling. Sometimes people are ugly and sometimes people are mean, and it just is. And the moment that we get to that point that we realize that we cannot fix crazy again is a moment of enlightenment, and it is a moment of like triumph. And I have since used that probably too many times to count. You just can't fix crazy. All right. Next one. Play it out. Okay. Here's the mantra for that. Play it out. We often hear it all. Oh, you know, let it play out. This is a cliche. Let it play out. However, my wise old crazy girl says, when I tell her, you have so much energy, you need to calm down, she says, no, I'm just going to play it out. Play it out. And then here's my translation. All you get is now, right? All you get is now. The past has gone. The future is still to come. So the present is all we have. So play it out. Let's see what happens. Well, be in the here, be in the now, be here right now. While you're having a great meal at a great restaurant and you just ordered an appetizer, don't start thinking about the dessert. Enjoy your appetizer. The time will come for the dessert, right? Don't be concerned. While you read a book, notice where your thoughts are. Are you with the book? Do you know what's going on with that? Run with it. Run with it when you can and play. Enjoy your life. Make the commitment to live joyfully in the moment. Decide to live fully in the present. By doing so, you're going to remove anxiety, stress, illnesses. You know, people are actually telling you, I mean, I know you've heard this many times before. Live right now, where you are right now. Yesterday is over with. Let it go. Right? Do not mark yourself. Do not mark who you are right now by yesterday's mishaps, yesterday's adventures, yesterday's greatness. Don't mark yourself by that. Keep going. Go forward. But for right now, enjoy where you are in this moment. Because while you're here, that's all that you have right now at this moment. This is what you're guaranteed. And I know that sounds so existential, and I kind of have issue with that when I try to think about it in my own life, but that is the reality. We are so kind of conditioned, you know, taught to think about our future and to feel guilt over our past or to feel shame over our past. Or many people I know are living in their glory days and the best part of their life has been their past. And so I want you all to think about what is going on right now. And in this moment in time, right now, everything for you is perfect. Everything that you need, everything that you have, everything that you want for your life is happening right now. So go with it right now. Play it out. Play. Have fun. Have joy in it. You know, again, there's so many articles written about this. Use the good silverware. Use, you know, light the pretty candles. You use the good sheets. Don't save all the fancy stuff for company. Have a good life. Okay. All right. Next one. Here's the kind of a question phrase of the week. And this is still ongoing in a child's mind, especially my child's mind. she will give me something that is a statement, and then she'll say, is that a good idea? Is that a good idea? Do you think that's a good idea? And she actually already knows in her mind that it's a good idea. But I think, wow, that's awesome to know, because what about us? When we make choices, or when we don't make choices, or where we act impulsively, or when we stand back and do nothing, do we often wonder, you know, was that a good idea? And we don't. And here's what happens with that. We have regret. And one, in my opinion, one of the worst things that you can do is to have regret, because you can't go back and change it. Nothing is going to change it. You get to make a decision right then, right there, and live with it. And then tomorrow, you wish you wouldn't have done something that you did, or you wish you would have done something that you did. So my encouragement to you is to resist impulse, to ask, is that a good idea? To resist the impulse. Pretend. Think as a kid does. Imagine, what is going to happen either way? What's going to happen if I make this choice? What's going to happen if I make this choice? What's going to happen if I make no choice and let something happen on its own? Hold yourself accountable. Too many times people don't hold themselves accountable for what we do, me included. I think everyone does that. I think it is so much easier to pretend it didn't happen, or to blame someone else for some of our own discourse. I think we need to say, I am accountable for this, and I am going to make a choice, and let me think of what's going to happen. Choice A, B, C, D, E, however many choices you need to go. Do a pro cons list if you need to. All I'm asking of all of us is to stop, step back, and think before we act. I tell this to my teen clients all the time. Think about that. Think before you act. When you stop making choices, then you enter into a world of excuses, all right? So excuses are not the same thing as explanations. And if you listen to me often enough, and if you really watch the show on a regular basis, you're going to hear this from me. And this is kind of one of those things that you'll want to come through the screen and thump me on the head, is that explanations are not the same thing as excuses. Explaining why something happened and being able to explain the past and explain what led you up to these behaviors is not the same thing as excusing it. I can explain a lot of things I did every day, but I do not get to excuse it through my behaviors, okay? So a wise person told me that every action has a reaction. Definitely, right? Every choice you make has a consequence. Consequence good, consequence bad. Don't hold on to the term consequence and let it be a bad thing. All right, let me leave this topic. I could probably talk about this all day, but I'm not going to intentionally bore you. So when the choice is to be right or to be kind, always make the choice that brings peace, right? Everybody wants to be right all the time, but you know what? Sometimes that does not bring you peace. So think about your choices and go on. All right. Okay. I need to quit saying all right. All right. The next one, look in the giraffe's eyes. Look in the giraffe's eyes. Now, doesn't this just sound so insightful? This was such a huge thing for us. This totally warranted having its own section of time tonight. Look in the giraffe's eyes. This mother, okay, spent $35 on a mother and child pair stuffed animal at Toys R Us because me just wanting to buy the little baby, which was about $12, okay, walking out the store, let's get a toy, we're out of here. And she says, Mom, look in the giraffe's eyes. She knows that her baby is not going to be with her. Do you really want to leave them there like that? Yeah, I actually did. But again, I'm trying to learn. I'm trying to be a good person. Here's what I'm going to take from that. This is empathy, right? Empathy. If you look into this little mama giraffe's eyes, you couldn't have possibly have left it without the baby, right? Putting yourself in someone else's shoes. That's what empathy is, putting yourself in someone else's shoes. It is not the same thing as sympathy. Sympathy is feeling sorry for someone. It is hoping that that did not happen or wishing that that did not happen on someone. Empathy is, gosh, what would that feel like if it were me? You know, what would that feel like? And where I go from this is what I want you to know is be open to everything. When we look at someone, we're translating this now into our empathy. And what empathy means and how you develop some kind of empathy is open your mind. Let go of your preconceived, your attachments or your notions of what you think. Open your mind to all possibilities, because what you believe to be an impossible, either way, you're right. If you believe it to be impossible or if you believe it to be impossible, you're right. So I encourage you to go with the flow that it is possible. You don't know what someone's story is. You don't know what it is that they have going on. Catch people doing right. We are so centered on trying to believe the bad in people. We are so, again, conditioned. That's going to be the word of the night, conditioned. We are so conditioned on seeing and believing everyone to be bad until they prove us good that we don't reverse that. We don't look at them and think, maybe they're good and I'm just having a bad day. Maybe I'm giving them money on the street corner and maybe they're actually going to go use it to benefit them. So maybe this is a good thing. Okay, let's catch them doing that. Let's stop catching our employees, you know, getting off the clock early. Let's stop catching them do these bad things. Let's stop catching them playing on the internet. Let's start catching them doing their projects on time. Let's start catching our kids being home early and being respectful to each other. Let's start doing that, okay? Because when we judge another person, all right, that doesn't really define them. So when we look at them and we're making these assumptions and we're making these claims, we're judging them, right? And I think if I ask each of you all individually, and if you were all in my sessions and I was all in your house visiting you and we're having a delightful time, none of us would ever say that we did something, that we judged anyone. We would say, oh, no, we don't judge. But I am telling you, when we judge someone else, when we define them as who we are, as who they are, we're not really. We're actually defining us. When we define other people, we're really defining ourselves. This is getting kind of deep, isn't it? And we're all talking about what a little four-year-old's teaching me. I can't imagine what like a two-year-old could teach me in this situation. So what do I want to do about this with empathy? What should we do with this? We should practice being generous. Practice being generous whenever you can. And I'm sure you hear this all the time, and I'm sure you see this all the time. I'm sure people are always asking for your generosity. But you know what? What if you give it just openly? What if you just give people benefit of the doubt? That's generosity. It's not always in the form of tokens, and it's not always in the form of money. It's in the form of goodwill, right? There's songs. We just got through with Christmas. We all did all of that. Goodwill to mankind. Just do good to everyone. Think about them. Think about what it must be like to be in their shoes and to choose this moment in your life and time not to judge them, but instead to look upon yourself and say, you know, what can I do for them? What can I do for someone else? The more that you give to other people, the more empathetic you are going to be. And the more you're going to buy the mama and the baby giraffes. All right, we're going to take a break. Come back with me in just a few minutes.
Hi, this is Michelle Paulette from WTOE Radio. We're going to take a few extra minutes while we save our files for podcast, so don't go anywhere. We'll be back in 4 short minutes.
Hey, Jack, you got a sec?
Yeah, sure, come on in.
Yeah, I was wondering if you... Jack, your hair's on fire.
Yeah, I know. I just need to finish this sales report, and then I'll probably, I don't know, let me lie down for a bit. But I'm sure it'll go away.
But the flames are getting bigger. Shouldn't I... Your hair, there's so much fire.
No, I'll be fine. What can I help you with? Oh, dear. Well, at least we know the sprinkler system works.
You wouldn't ignore this, so why ignore the signs of a stroke? If you or someone you know suddenly experiences numbness of the face, arm, or leg, or sudden trouble speaking, seeing, or walking, don't wait to get help. Call 911 right away, because time lost is brain lost. To find out more, visit www.strokeassociation.org or call 1-888-4-STROKE. This message brought to you by the American Stroke Association and the Ad Council.
Statistics say that 4 out of 10 high school students will drop out of high school. But sometimes the difference between dropping out and finishing is a boost.
I just try to motivate my friends as much as I can. Just get done with that credit. Just get that thing.
If you don't have anybody while you're in school, then there's not really a way to get through it.
I had a very good friend who was thinking about dropping out completely. And I just talked to him about it, told him that it was a stupid idea for him to do that. You know, he's gone so far and he's only got a year left.
There's one girl named Maria. She just told me to get my things straight. She told me if I ever needed anything that she'll be right there. Even my friends that have dropped out tell me, oh, it's staying in school. It's not easy to leave it. You think it's the best thing, but then when you've done it, you realize that it wasn't.
10 real-life at-risk students are filming their year, so you can see what it's really like trying to get through high school. Go to boostup.org to see their stories and give someone you know a boost so they can finish. High school is hard. Graduating is harder. Brought to you by the U.S. Army and the Ad Council.
Are you stuck in front of your computer listening to our shows? Well, you may be happy to know that you don't have to be anymore. Hi, this is Keith Zalley, your announcer here at WTOE Radio. Of course you know we broadcast live on ThroughOurEyes.org, but did you know we simulcast on Facebook, Ustream.tv, as well as all of our show's host websites? And now you don't have to be stuck trying to catch your favorite show on your computer. You can listen or even watch our shows live right on your smartphone or iPad. During broadcast nights, just point your phone or iPad browser to our mobile site, m.throughoureyes.org, and click on the Listen or Watch Live link. WTOE also offers many smart apps for your iPhone, BlackBerry, Android, Windows Mobile, or Nokia phones, iPads too. All for free. Visit our main site, www.throughoureyes.org/appstores.html, and download your free app today.
Have you ever lost a cat? And have you ever wanted to get your cat back after you lost it? Hi there, I'm Andrew Hoffman. I went on this website called inventnow.org. Then I decided to make an invention of my own. It's called the Lost Cat Magnet Invention. So you can get your cat back after you lost it. Just turn it on and lost cats stick to it. That's a good cat. If your cat was hiding up in a tree, it won't be up a tree anymore. It will be stuck to the Lost Cat Magnet. And sometimes they fly toward you in the air. Just listen to one satisfied cat. See, that's proof. You should go to the inventnow.org website too. But just remember one thing, don't do a lost cat magnet.
Anything's possible. Keep thinking. Get started on your own inventions or just play some games at inventnow.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, the National Inventors Hall of Fame Foundation, and the Ad Council.
And now, back to Stepping Forward. Here's Tamara.
Welcome back. Okay, so we've gone over 6 of kind of the crazy things that Emma has discussed that I want to relay to you all. And let's go on to the next one. Who wants to eat cake? Who wants cake if you can't eat it? Have you guys all heard this, right? It's like you can't have your cake and eat it too. And I don't remember what we were talking about, looking at, watching at the time, and I just totally laughed because she looks at me and she's like, "Mom, who wants cake if you can't eat it?" And I'm thinking, you know what? You were so right. All right, good point. Go for it. And what this is telling you is that you're supposed to look for something in your life. You're supposed to get what you want, have ambition, set your sights on something, okay? Don't settle for just what it is. One of the humanitarians, Khalil Gibran, said, and let me quote him so I get this right. When you're born, your work is in your heart. So ask yourself this, what's your passion? What is your work? Are you living what your heart is urging you to do? Do you know what you have to do to feel whole, to feel complete, to feel as if you're fulfilling your destiny? Do you know how to do that? Do you actually take the time to think about it? Because sometimes we think of that as a very egocentric kind of focus, is that, wait, I don't have time to think about myself. I don't have time to think about what's going on with me. I need to focus on everyone else. And again, go back to 1 through 6 that we've already talked about. If you're not okay, then there is no possible way that anyone around you is going to be okay. And in the mind of a child, and all of this comes from a child's view, it's just so innocent, it's so pure, but it's honestly all that you need to know. It's all that any of us need to know. Sometime through life, you have been conditioned, I have been conditioned, everyone around us has been taught that it's not okay. It is not okay to be self-focused. It is not okay to wish for things that we wish for as a kid. And I'm gonna say that that's wrong. That's just absolutely wrong. You know what? Wish for your cake. Eat it too. Why are you not gonna eat your cake? I'm sure that there is much more historical meaning to this than, you know, what I am giving you right now. But I am telling you, ask yourself, are you fulfilling your destiny? Are you at a place in your life that you feel very comfortable? Is this what you want to do? It's a new year, right? It's a new year. You have resolutions. Everyone says, hey, here's what I'm going to do. I watched, 28 shows today that discuss New Year's resolutions, right? And they say the top 10. The top 10 New Year's resolutions are the same as they were last year. And they're probably going to be the same as next year and the year after and the way that they were 15 years ago. Because we don't change. We don't adapt. We adapt. We do whatever is required of us, what is expected of us, to be in society's views. We do not live for ourselves. And if one of your New Year's resolutions is to be ultimately successful and in career-wise and do everything, then you're probably already reading self-help books. And I'm going to tell you, if you're reading these self-help books, what they are going to teach you, what they are going to tell you, and what they are going to expound on is, please take care of yourself and please know that your goals and your wishes for your life and who you want to be and who you want to be remembered as and what you want for your life is as important as losing the 10 pounds that you feel like you're going to gain from someone else's perception of who you are and who you should be. All right. Okay. So I'm all about quotes tonight. So let me give you another one regarding this. I have to give you important quotes because I can't let you leave here thinking that the only quotes I can give you are from a four-year-old. Hey, although she's on the money a little bit. All right. So, Michelangelo, as he suggested, the greater danger is not that your hopes are too high and that you fail to reach them. It's that they're too low and that you actually do. All right? We're all better than this. You're better than you can imagine. So do that. Okay. Don't settle when. I could also reference Charlie Sheen from last year who says, when, duh. Okay, but see, I chose for Michelangelo. All right, next one. Sweet little Emma. Mom, I wished upon the brightest star. I wished on the brightest star. Emma, this sweet little crazy girl, you are on the money. Dream your dreams, set your goal, keep your positive thoughts, dance, keep on wishing, okay? Be inspired. This is what this tells us. Wish on the brightest star. Who doesn't know that? You did not learn this as a 30-something-year-old adult. Oh, look, there's a bright star. Let's wish on it. You didn't learn it at 30 years old. You learned it as a kid. You learned that when you were a child, this is what we do. We wish upon stars. Okay? So as long as you get up in the morning, look at yourself in the mirror. Like what you see. If you like what you see, that's success. That is success. All right? Again, be inspired. Begin picturing yourself having the skills to do the things that you would like to become. Again, to become inspired, place your thoughts on what you would like to become. It goes back to our whole cake talk, right? Do what you know you have to do to feel complete in your life. Be remembered the way that you want to be remembered. Wish on the star. Be inspired. Place your thoughts on who you want to become and start living your life like that. Live your life like that. How awesome would that be? Start picturing yourself as having the skills to do these things. The more you see yourself as what you'd like to become, the more inspired that you are. See the future as you want it and act that way. See people in your lives that way. See your relationships as positive. We have a relationship with everyone that we touch base with. It doesn't have to be a personal, intimate relationship. It can be in a relationship with someone in your book club or the grocery store. Have a relationship with people. Look at them. They're the same as you are. They go home every day. They do everything that you do every day. Look at them as real people. Be inspired. Look at them and say, you know what? You do an amazing job at what you do. I do an amazing job at what I am. Here are the goals that I wish for myself. You cannot convince me, and you will not convince my children, because I won't allow that, and they won't allow that any of us are less than any celebrity status. You are as celebratory as they are, as I am, as anyone down the street are, as the homeless are, anyone. The difference is desire, intention, and goals. Shoot for them, go for them, believe in them, believe in yourself. This is absolutely not only possible, but probable if you allow yourself to do that. Okay? All right. Kind of getting to where I'm a little preachy at this point. Okay, so when I wrote this article about Emma, this is sweet Emma right here on your screen. When I wrote this article about her, it was, again, after I had completed several series and play therapy and trying to listen to children and knowing that as adults, we are just really big kids and we just try to use more verbiage, bigger words, although sometimes I lose all my big words and I talk like a kid most of the day. So when I was doing this, she was 4 years old. And I know all of you were with me, and we had this horrid, horrid, horrid tragedy in Newtown, Connecticut, right prior to Christmas. And it made us all remember children and what it is that they can bring to us and everything that we owe them and we owe ourselves. And in doing that, my child at this time, who's now 6 years old, who has just given us 8 huge things of wisdom, right? I doubt that she meant it exactly as I've translated it to you, but we're going to go with that. After that, me, as most of you all and everyone who knows children at that time did, kind of hugged our kids a little bit closer. And the Friday, a week Friday from the horrible shooting, I took my daughter to a movie and we saw The Rise of the Guardians. And if you are not fortunate enough to have a child that you still see animated movies with, this was about all of our heroes from the past of childhood, the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny and Santa Claus. And the Sandman, you know, and man, I feel like I'm on the Oscars. Sorry if I forgot someone. But so this is what this movie was about. And as we walked out after watching the movie, Emma and I, and there was a couple of men behind us. And she said, I said, that was a really good movie, Emma. And she said, yeah, you know what was about good versus evil, right? And I said, yeah, but I was really getting concerned at the end, you know, because I'm totally trying to act cool and I fail miserably at that most times. And she responded with, Mom, you know good always wins, right? And because of the timing, because of everything, because of, you know, I don't even know. That was by far none the most enlightenment I had had in a very large time. But these men behind me kind of patted her on the back and they said, you know what? You're right, little one. You're right. We need to all remember that. She, of course, looked at me like, hello, what is this talking about? But one of my favorite authors is Dr. Wayne Dyer, and he said, you know what? Loving people live in a loving world, and hostile people live in a hostile world. It's the same world. We're all in the same world. So we get to make a choice on what happens. And we get to make a choice every day on how we choose to live our lives. And I hope that you don't look at this as a very benign, comical, kid-like view of the world. Because, you know, how many of you all, how many of me, all of us, have we all wished that we could go back and have that innocence in our mind where good always wins. Snakes are just snakes, and wishing on the star is going to fix the world, right? I'm going to play until I'm tired. I want you to put the milk the way I want it. I know that this machine cannot be fixed because it's crazy. I know I have a great idea, and I'm going to eat my cake. I'm going to eat my cake. I'm going to wish for a cake, and I'm going to eat it. And I think that we all want that. I think everybody wants that. So I'm going to leave you with this. This is something I was talking to you about earlier, about Robert Fulman's All I Really Need to Know I Learned in Kindergarten. Because now my crazy, crazy little Emma is in kindergarten, And she is more enlightened than ever. And if I could sit her on the couch at my office every day and let her analyze and be the therapist for all of my clients, I might make more money and they might walk out of here with more insight. But until then, I'm going to use her as my secret weapon. And I am going to continue to translate for her until she decides to become some amazing person on her own. All right. So forgive me now, because I'm going to kind of look off and read these things that came directly from Robert Fullman. And it's all I really need to know that I learned in kindergarten. Okay. Great. Share everything. Play fair. Don't hit people. Put things back where you found them. Can I please get this? I need to get this in a bold addition to my older children. Clean up your own mess. Clean up your own mess. Do you all now want to put this in a bold version for yourselves? Don't take things that aren't yours. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Okay, let me go back. Remember the empathy thing? Say you're sorry. Be accountable. Be accountable to yourself. Be accountable to other people. Say you're sorry. Say you're sorry when you hurt somebody. Wash your hands before you eat. We do this in kindergarten. Flush. Need I say more? Warm cookies and cold milk are good for you. Ask Santa. Extra warm cookies are good for you too. Sometimes you need a second. Sometimes seconds are good. I'm just going to say it. Learn some, drink some, draw some, paint some, sing, dance, play, work, every day. That's leading a balanced life, right? That's leading a balanced life. Take a nap every day. I love that. When you go out into the world, watch out for traffic, hold hands, and stick together. Remember your person. Everybody needs to have a person. If you don't have a person, go find them. Find them. Be aware of wonder. And this one, you know what? I cannot say this enough. Be aware of wonder. To a child, everything is magic. Everything is magical. Everything is wonderful. Remember the little seed in the styrofoam cup? No, the roots go down. The plant goes up. And nobody really knows how or why. But we're all like that. Goldfish and hamster, white mice, and even the little seed in the styrofoam cup, they all die. So do we. That's sad. But again, let's go back to where we talked about living for the moment, okay? Live for today. Do what you can. Okay, last one. I say, remember the Dick and Jane books? And the first word you learned? They're not really Dick and Jane books anymore, but maybe back in my day. Remember the Dick and Jane books and the first words that you learned? And the biggest word of all was look. L-O-O-K. Look. Observe. This is everything that I taught you in this whole first hour. It's everything that I talked about is just observe. Just be in awe of everything around you. Enjoy your life for what it is. Just take it in the moment, take it as it is. Be proud of who you are. Know that this is your moment. I mean, I can't stress this enough that this is a new year. You're going to make resolutions to do something amazing for your life. You're going to. It's what we do. And I want to encourage you for your emotions and to do something for a new life, to be who you want to be and to be proud of that person and to go forward with it and to not let anything step in the way. And remind yourself, if anything, if you're making a choice in your life, go for the kind choice. Do what's kind, do what's right, because abundance will come for you tenfold when you do the right thing. Wish on the star, eat your cake, think about yourself. Don't fix crazy, don't waste your time trying to fix something that cannot be fixed. Play, enjoy the moment. Ask yourself, is that a good idea? Then go with that. All right. Is that a good idea? Look into the giraffe's eyes. I hope that you guys will never look at a giraffe the same way again. And I hope you don't, because it cost me $35. To have empathy, it cost me $35. So if you can't see something nice, don't say anything and eat your cake. I don't know. So I have so much enjoyed this. I have been so excited to talk about children's views, because obviously our children do not get to speak for themselves enough. So I am thoroughly excited that I get to translate for them all and share their point of view to you. And who in our lives are the most happy? It's the kids. So doesn't that kind of teach us that we should act like them? All right, you guys, I'm going to see you in February. We're going to talk again right before it's time to be lovey-dovey for the 14th and all that good stuff. I hope none of you have lost sight of your New Year's resolutions. And feel free to email me, ask me questions, do whatever you need to do, twhitecounseling@yahoo.com, or on my website, twhitecounseling.net. All right. I look forward to talking to all of you. Let's call tonight's Out of the Mouths of Babes. All right. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you so much. It's a world of laughter, a world of tears. It's a world of hopes and a world of fears. There's so much that we share that it's time we're aware. It's a small world after all. 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 It's a small, small world.
Stepping Forward with Tamara White, a licensed professional counselor and clinical psychologist, was brought to you by the WTOE Radio TV Network at throughoureyes.org. For more information on tonight's show, or to reach Tamara directly, you may email her at twhitecounseling@yahoo.com or visit twhitecounseling.net. That's twhitecounseling.net. Special thanks to the numerous individuals and families that have stepped outside of the box to enlist assistance through therapy. All words, ideas, and comments expressed on Stepping Forward are those of Tamara White and not necessarily those of the National Federation of the Blind, the NFB of New Jersey, or the WTOE Radio TV Network. Until next time, I'm Michelle Paulette.
Got it again.
And that's all, folks.